Welcome to this tree mob on the topic of etiolation for propagation. I'm Pam Thompson, Manager of Adult Education with the Arnold Arboretum, and I'll be hosting today's mob. Our speaker today is Christine Ventura, Arnold Arboretum Living Collections Fellow. During her fellowship, she's focusing on creating a new plant introduction program for the Arnold Arboretum. This initiative will make some of the Arboretum's most exciting accessions available to the horticultural trade and the public. Initiatives such as research on clonal propagation and methods for recalcitrant taxa, reacquiring and propagating important and historic Arnold Arboretum lineages, and performing propagation research related to the campaign for living collections will also be within her purview. So welcome, Christine, and thank you very much for doing this mob today.
Thank you so much, Pam, for the introduction. And welcome everyone to the Explorer's Garden. This is home to plants grown mostly from seed gathered on expeditions by Arboretum staff and keepers of the living collections from Wilson to Dozeman, with guidance from our global community of plant experts. Some of the earliest accessions of individuals that the Arboretum is famous for can be found here. I'm standing in front of Torreya grandis, or the nutmeg yew. It's named this because of the similar fruit and also foliage. The cultivars of this tree have been cultivated for over 1,200 years in eastern and southeastern China. The edible seed has anti-inflammatory properties, and its timber is also highly valuable. Cultivars have been selected over generations, and seed of this individual was collected by Peter Del Tredegy back in 1990. So the Arboretum generally uses vegetative propagation to reproduce plants, important plants of the Arboretum. And this is because we are trying to maintain lineages for curatorial, research, historical, and conservation purposes. This tree in 2018, a branch from a nearby oak tree fell, and you can still see the scars left on the trunk. For this reason, it was placed on a repropagation list that we maintain in order to make sure that we don't lose any of these valuable lineages. In 2019, we trialed an air layer project, which is basically the removal of some bark from a branch and then installation of a moss-filled bag in order to keep the plant alive while root tissue is generated. All of those air layers proved to be unsuccessful last year, although 10 softwood cuttings appear to be viable. This year, we added it to the list of plants that we'll be trying on the etiolation and banding repropagation technique. So etiolation is the process of producing elongated growth by shading plant tissue. And the banding process promotes rooting in a region of the stem by applying hormones to a strip, a Velcro strip, and applying that to the stem so that it continues to be shaded and it increases the duration of the hormone applied to the stem. This method was developed by Dr. Brian Maynard and Dr. Nina Bassuk. Nina's lab is at Cornell, and Dr. Maynard's lab is at URI. And they actually patented the process in 1989. If you want to show the... So the process works by delaying the differentiation of cells in target tissue. You can see that it's kind of a continuum. There's a zone of cell division, and then kind of following that, cells elongate, and behind that, after these cells elongated, they'll tend to differentiate into the different tissues that they're going to become. There are some kind of predestined routes. There are leaf primordia, vascular tissue primordia, but with etiolation, you're kind of delaying the process, especially in woody plants, of these tissues really lignifying. Lignin is the compound that makes woody plants woody, and that makes them more kind of susceptible to manipulation to develop into other tissues, in this case, root tissue. So I'm going to bring you guys in a little bit closer so that you can actually see this process at work, if you'll bear with me. Okay, so here is one of our enclosures. We generally will try to time it appropriately so that we enclose plant stems around the time that they begin elongating, but before they have a chance to really harden up. The material that I'm using is actually used as a landscape cover to completely shade out undesirable plants, you know, weeds, and blocks, I'd say about 99% of sunlight. And because we don't actually want to inhibit the growth of the plant entirely, we have this frame. It's actually a tree guard to prevent damage from equipment and deer browsing. And that just gives a little space for the plant tissue to develop. Now, inside these enclosures, if you want to try this at home, I would advise that you check it at least once a week and be aware. I cleared out this area prior to the beginning of this tree mob because you can find some critters in here and it can be quite surprising. I actually had a nice encounter with white-faced hornets while I was checking out an Australia red Ariana. Yeah, you'll just want to stand back a few feet if it's the first time you've opened it in a while. So you can see here the difference. This is last year's growth, and this is this year's growth. And you have these characteristics of etiolation. There's less chlorophyll in the leaves. They're a little less green, and there's a little more space in between the leaf nodes. You'll have here some critter has been at work eating the leaves or removing them for some other purpose. And that's one reason that it's an advantage to quickly harden up your tissue and lignify it as an evolutionary advantage, because you can avoid having your plants being, having your body parts being eaten. So basically the process involves removing some of these lower leaves, applying the Velcro. Here I've already treated these with hormone, and I basically have made a little sandwich. For a larger branch, you could probably take a longer strip and wrap it around the branch, but I found this works really well. And you can just kind of enclose it over. I'll use one of the ones that hasn't been defoliated, and just very gently remove any leaves. On a hardwood, it's a bit easier. I used to play around a lot as a kid with different plant parts and kind of torture them by taking them apart. And I had no idea that would prove to be a valuable skill to have as an adult. So there you see the hormone. And you really want to get as far down to the base as you can. And you can even press it a little bit to maybe just slightly damage the dermal tissue of the plant. And so I would, in most cases, treat every single one of these. You want to make sure that it's long enough to accommodate both the band and have some developing tissue. And then after you apply all the bands, you would gradually acclimate the tissue to light. So I just use materials that are on hand. Everything is kind of plastic so that it's not, and a lot of moisture isn't hanging around the plant. But if you weren't worried about that, if you were using a stock plant in a greenhouse or a more controlled environment, you could use potentially burlap. But I find this works really well. It's just shade cloth And here, by the time I have it wrapped around, it will be about, I'd say 75% shade. In a week, I would come back and remove one layer. So then it's, you know, maybe 50% shade. And then after that, I would just leave this cage on for another 2 weeks to allow it to continue to acclimate before taking the cuttings off, keeping them in a humid environment until they're stuck into media of 50% perlite and 50% sand under a very high humidity environment that you can either achieve under a dome and frequently spritzing it, or we have a mist house at the Dana greenhouses that will keep the humidity about 90% for the rest of the summer until you know, the roots are evident. So I'll just pop this back on. And another thing you want to consider is just keeping your branch secure. I experimented a lot in the early spring. We had some high winds. I did find that some of these enclosures were moved around quite a bit and had some failures due to that. So you can either, you know, strap this right to the branch or an adjacent branch. I found that my trials with additional support structures, sticks and whatnot, were really kind of susceptible to the vagaries of Mother Nature. So what I ended up doing was making these kind of chains of zip ties and coming from a stronger branch and attaching to that. So it allowed for some movement in the wind, but not enough to break branches. So here are my two layers, and I'll come back and treat the rest of these at the end of this talk. And you can see up above, I have a couple more that have already been treated. And then when you're using the Propex material, the really heavy shade cloth, it's good to leave some gaps. That does invite visitors, like this guy over here. You know, critters can get in there a little more easily, but I find that, especially in a really sunny environment, it can, you know, keep the enclosure from overheating. Give it a little tuck. With the lighter shade cloth, there's a little more air movement, so you don't have to worry quite so much. All right. And there you have it.
One question is, what weight of Velcro, like a flexible Velcro or a stiff Velcro?
I actually used, I used two different kinds. I have one box right here. This is the Industrial Strength Extreme 624. I found that to be a bit heavy. I don't have the box for the lighter gauge, but I do have a few kind of examples. So I kind of combined the two, the 624, mm-hmm. which is this kind of, I'll hold it a little closer, heavier Velcro, and then this much, much lighter one that barely has any teeth. And I found that I preferred using that both because, you know, the larger teeth, you're working with such delicate tissues that you don't really want to crush things. And it also is quite difficult to separate once you've got it together. So when you're pulling it apart, you really don't want to damage your, you know, very fragile etiolated tissue with the force that it takes to separate it. So I found that kind of a combination of the two worked really well. And I can kind of flip them around and reconfigure them based on the width of the stem. Mm-hmm. And how sturdy things were. We did some work on Paulownia tomentosa, and really for something with a stem as thick as that, and there's really no stage that you can get it where the stem is going to be small. It's just, you know, I'd say about a half inch diameter stem you're working with, in contrast to this, which is, you know, less than a 16th of an inch or a couple millimeters. So really it's good to have kind of two sort of strengths to adapt your technique. But this was the first year that we've done this here. There was quite a bit of trial and error. There were some successes and failures. Well, hopefully successes. We won't know until the fall, because that is the goal, is to have your cuttings survive the winter and then be transplanted. Sorry.
Okay. Sorry. We can see you. Thank you. So someone is saying they're not understanding how this differs from air layering with sphagnum moss. Can you compare the two methods a bit?
So I would say this is maybe a little bit lower risk, because with air layering, you're choosing a larger, generally larger stem that's further along in development, and you're removing the bark all the way down to the cambium. So once that's accomplished, if you don't develop roots, then you're going to have to remove that stem. And with etiolation, you're using new growth on the stem tips, and in that case, you're going to lose less biomass, unless you're working with something that's really on its last legs. It gives you a little more room for error than the air layer, and it's, I would argue, there's probably less checking. The vascular tissue is still connected to the plant with air layers. If you're installing something that's relatively inaccessible, you know, you have to get up there and kind of re-moisten the media, especially a summer like this. We did have a lot of air layer failures, just because it was so dry and we could only get out so often to check those. This has a sort of a quicker turnaround once you've, you know, noticed that the plant has decided to go and develop those stems. You've got basically, you know, a month-long period where you go from the banding to getting your cuttings, and it's just potentially a little bit quicker, where we leave the air layers as late as we can in the season, just to give them a good chance of developing roots. Mm-hmm. Also, with the air layering, with the moss, if you're moving it around and looking for roots, you're potentially damaging any roots that are developing. So you're kind of, it's more of a mystery. Last year when we collected our air layers, there were a few that just actually, from this tree in particular, that looked wonderful, and we got the moss ball apart and there were just no roots. It had just been able to hang on to its leaves and look good, but none of them were viable in terms of developing roots.
Can you just describe, for people who don't know that sphagnum moss and air layering technique, it looks very much like this, except that container or sack has the sphagnum wrapped right around the branch, right?
Yeah, let's see if I can like improvise with some materials. So this would be maybe a good candidate branch for an air layer, maybe something like this. You would take a pretty sharp knife and score around the stem in two places, remove all of the bark down to the cambium there, and then just pretend this glove is a piece of plastic that you would wrap around it, and this mulch would be your media. You would kind of tuck that in there. You would take your space that you had created in the stem, you would wrap the moss around, moisten it, and then apply zip ties to the top and bottom so that the moisture would sustain, you know, the rest of the foliage's moisture needs, and the leaves would be able to provide the nutrients. Basically, because you've cut down to the cambium, nothing is moving from here into the stem anymore, and everything is kind of stopping here. So you've created a sort of a new basal region on the stem, which by doing that, the this part of the plant is signaling that, you know, roots go here. So the cells that are dividing from that cambium are more likely to differentiate into root cells.
Great, thank you. And likewise, can you go back to the other one?
Okay.
That is, there's still movement of nutrients.
Right, you're just removing any kind of leaves or anything that would impede the adhering of the Velcro, and you know, the leaves are no longer signaling that that is a source of carbohydrates and that there's, you know, light there. So yeah, the vasculature of the plant is able to flow through. We don't have to input any moisture. And although there is a reduced amount of almost entirely reduced amount of photosynthesis for a short period of time, you know, the tissue is able to kind of be sustained until it's removed entirely.
So when you open that up for your final time, what are you looking for? What are you expecting to see?
So each time that I reduce the amount of shade, I'm looking to see that there is more chlorophyll in the leaves, and that's telling me that the plant is acclimating. And then I want to see that the stem is a little more rigid. I don't remove the Velcro until I get it back to the greenhouse to be, you know, stuck. And at that point, I'm not expecting to see any roots, but maybe a little bit of callusing. It's just a region of, you know, a high level of cell division that has the potential to become hopefully roots. And then at that point, I would take that kind of shaded region around the band and insert that below the surface of the media in order to continue to encourage roots to form.
Great, thank you. And how many, it looks like you've done several of these on this tree.
Yes, it depends on the, you know, the health of the plant and the availability of the tissue. You certainly don't want to take a healthy plant, you know, and or a not so healthy plant and take its last options for viability away. If there are branches that are aesthetically or, you know, plant health-wise favorable to take, I would err on taking branches like that. We had a very small Astraea rhodariana that had just been planted out from the greenhouse nursery, and it had a kind of a competing leader that came all the way from the bottom. And I felt comfortable taking that whole branch, so I enclosed the entire branch. And the, you know, another advantage to doing something like that is that the chemical signaling inside the plant is not necessarily going to divert all resources away from that branch and allow that tissue to die. It's such a large area enclosed that it's going to kind of carry on anyway. But in the case of something that's really hard to access, or the tree that's on its last legs, or just take maybe one or two small branches here and there and just hope for success over time versus having multiple replicates that want, you know, with the aim of having guaranteed success that year. So it's really the value of the accession, the availability of tissue, and, you know, what just trying to increase your odds by having numerous replicates. This tree has three enclosures, and I hope to get about 20 cuttings from each of those enclosures.
Okay.
I mean, from all of those enclosures together.
You said this is the first time you're trying this at the Arboretum. Is that correct?
Yes, yes. This year was a different year. And it's the beginning of my second year here at the Arboretum. I had planned on spending a lot of time in the tissue culture lab that we've been getting set up. But just after we collected our first tissue to begin trials on procedures there, we were shut down by COVID and lost access to that lab. So I really pivoted to more outdoor propagation activities in order to stay productive during that time.
Great. Can you say a little bit about the kind of the resurrection and renewal of the plant propagation program for sharing different plants?
The introduction program, previously we did have several iterations of introductions. I mean, during the Sargent era, we arguably released, you know, thousands of plants to horticulture, and Donald Wyman was, just a huge proponent of improving horticultural varieties available to the public. But following that period, the first and second 50 years, things really slowed down as far as introductions. There were fewer kind of named cultivars that came out, and really a lot of our interaction with bringing plants to the public came through the plant sale. Mm-hmm. And you know, people are interested in our plants. There are really some exciting and different cultivars here that have yet to be explored. So I'm kind of rallying the leadership here to give their ideas for plants that the public would be interested in, and combining that with a partnership with nurseries to bring those to nurseries, and so that the public can have our plants.
Do you have a list of plants that this technique has been tried on, or is this all? I'm sure you have. You know what you've done this year, but is that
the list
that can be publicized?
Yeah, it's a pretty short list. We've done Paulownia tomentosa, Astraea redariana, Ventura grandis, two cultivars. Well, one species and a cultivar of Colorotaria paniculata, Ginkgo biloba, and liquid ambar formosena, and that's it.
And those were chosen because you've had trouble propagating them through other methods, easier methods.
A couple of them have been really resistant to propagation, and one or two of them are just pretty rare. Yeah. So we wanted to you know, give it a good shot and try to get it right.
Great. I think that's all we have for questions, and I hope those take. I hope you get the results you're looking for on this tree and on all the ones that you've worked on. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks everybody for showing up.